All right. Well, it is a 7 o'clock hour. We want to welcome all of you that are joining us today. Those that are joining us live, those that are joining us on our Zoom, and also for those that will be seeing this on our YouTube channel, we just want to welcome all of you to this Friday night Shabbat Bible study. And I'm looking forward to getting into the Word today. We're still in the book of Exodus, covering some very, very important topics. But before I get started, I want to just give a quick shout out to my daughter, Tirana, and my granddaughter, Miss Kennedy Thomas. They played a little prank on me this weekend. It was Father's Day, and so they hid this little card. It says, "This is more than a Father's Day card, Dad. It's your present. Enjoy." And so I said, "Oh, really?" Right? So I said, "That's the best you could do this year." But I didn't trip, because I love them. I love them dearly. But they were pranking me, right? And so they were in the background, behind the scenes. They asked my wife, "Did he get the car? Did he get the car? Did he see it? Did he see it?" My granddaughter, and she said, "Yeah." So they had this gift hidden in my desk chair, and it was turned so I couldn't see it. And so my wife said, "Well, there's something for you in your chair. You didn't go look at it." And so I went to my chair and had a box, nice box there, and I opened up, and this nice polo shirt was inside, right? And when I saw it, I told my granddaughter, "I'm wearing this on my next video." And she got me a Detroit cap, right? So I'm not sure how long I'm gonna keep the Detroit hat on, because my head's in a sweat, when I get to preach it. But I definitely want to give her a shout out. I just let her know how much I greatly appreciate their love and their demonstration of love towards their big daddy. All right, so with that said, we're gonna go ahead and get started. And I want to share with you, I do want to share that in these Bible studies, I have a couple of purposes that I want to really accomplish. And I'm going to be covering this more in the video, but one of the very important missions that I have is to bring knowledge and awareness to the lost tribes of the house of Israel. We have been lost for centuries. And the Bible preached and it really talked about there's going to be an awakening, the shaking of the dry bones. And that's going on right now. And so it is very important that I complete that mission of getting the truth out to them, because there's a lot of camps out there and they're scattered, and the knowledge is coming to them gradually, but everybody's not quite on the same page. And so it's important that they get a full knowledge of the truth. So what I purpose to do is to go completely through the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, as the Most High says, and share this knowledge so they can get a clearer understanding, because some have come back believing in the Torah, but they have not embraced the importance of Yeshua HaMashiach, right? Jesus Christ, his purpose and his mission and his importance to this entire move. Some just have not acknowledged him. And to acknowledge the Torah without acknowledging Yeshua is, you're still incomplete, right? You're still incomplete. You can't save yourself. I don't care if you try to keep every law in the Torah. And never fail, you still gonna fall way short where the Father's concerned.
They're gonna fall short, because the scripture says where there's no shedding of blood,
Oh
there's
yeah,
no remission of
right,
sin.
right, right, right. So my wife was just commenting, it talked about the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. And certainly there are some who even believe in the restoration. And I taught on this even in the time I've been in the book of Exodus, about the priesthood. And how there's a doing away with the Levitical priesthood, and it's been established under a new covenant, a renewed covenant with greater promises under our priest now, who's after the order of Melchizedek. So we had a great lesson on that. But the bottom line is, he had to shed his blood for there to be a remission of sins. And so to try to come to the Father without going through Yeshua HaMashiach and acknowledging his blood sacrifice, it is a waste of time. I don't care how much you try to keep Torah, it is a waste of time. So I want to share that that is one of the underlying missions that I have. But secondly, my mission is to reach the lost, right? To reach the lost, and that's all peoples, all nations, all tongues. And so there are times when I'm sharing this word that I get very passionate because we have been, our history has been stolen from us. There's been a lot of lying, you know, and then there's the privileged ones. And I have Caucasian friends, and white people are not the problem, right? I want to say that they're not the problem. Though there are some people who are in power, they know they're in power and they abuse their power. You know, there because there is white privilege right now. That's just a given. You can be in this community today. You can get caught speeding. You can get caught doing felonies, and get slapped on the wrist and not get a record. You know, or you can get caught with a little bit of marijuana in your pocket, and you can be black, and you can end up with a felony, right? And do hard time, 20, 30, 40 years over silliness. So that's the imbalance that's in our community. And anyone that has lived in the 50s, in the 60s, you know, I was a 50s baby. My wife was a 60s baby. And so we know about those times. You know, we know times when, you know, you can watch TV all day and not see a black face on TV all day. Okay, that, you know, we used to, when I was a kid, you see somebody black on TV, you go outside, you start screaming, turn on channel 4, it's a black person on channel 4. I mean, that's how rare, you know, you would see us. So needless to say, all the heroes were Caucasian, you know, Superman. You know, you had this crazy guy swinging on ropes through Africa, dominating, defeating all, you know, whole tribes of people, hundreds and thousands of people. This one dude yelling, is dominating. So, you know, you get raised on that, and it has an impact. It has an impact on you. And then you don't see any heroes that look like you. And then our history has been stolen. You know, it's a difficult situation to grow up under, and I grew up under that, knowing that my skin color brought limitations, right? I knew that. Being a child, I could recognize you sense it, right? So I get passionate sometimes in my message when I'm bringing this word. I get very passionate about some of the things that I bring across. But I just want to let my Caucasian friends know that there's nothing personal. Because there is a place in the kingdom for all peoples, all nations, and all tongues who come before the Most High with a sincere heart. You know, and for those who are not sincere, and those who are abusing their privilege and abusing people, there's going to be a place for you. We're going to talk about that a little bit today. So I just want to share that, you know, as I go forth in these messages, that I'm not biased in any way. You know, I'm trying to bring the word out and this truth out with the best of my abilities. But I will get passionate from time to time. But, you know, I still love my white friends. You know, there are many friends that you know, bent their back for me, you know, and for my wife. And so, you know, this is not a racial issue. It is all about truth. It's all about truth. You know, our truth has been stolen. It's being restored. And for those that are in power and want to try to keep this truth hidden, is nothing you can do about this. You know, this truth is coming out, and there's nothing you can do about it. So I just wanted to share that, you know, in my opening today. But we're going to be covering some things today, even as we get into the book of Exodus and some additional side information that we're going to be covering today. And so with that said, we're going to go ahead and pray. Brugatai v'nai lahena malek ha'olam asher kishenu v'mitzvatav v'sivano la'asuk bedevri Torah. Blessed you, Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who sanctifies us with your commandments and command us to engross ourselves in the words of your Torah. And with that said, we're going to go ahead and get into this word. We always count it an honor and a privilege to do just that. So we're going to share our screen. All right. So you should be seeing my screen now. We're in the book of Exodus, part 16. And we're going to be discussing various offerings today, various offerings, including the sin offering. All right, so a quick recap of last week. As we continue our study of the consecration of priests, a process that was designed to make them holy before the Most High, we saw Aharon and his sons lay their hands on the head of the bull in obedience to the command of Yahweh. This symbolic action, which was commanded in the case of every sin offering, the offender identified himself with the animal and transferred to it the guilt of his own sins and imperfections. The animal thereby became accursed, and his death paid the penalty due to the sins laid upon it, and set free those who had committed them. And similarly, our Mashiach, our sin offering, was also made a curse for us. In Galatians 3 and 13, it says, Mashiach has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. And so those offerings that were given under Moshe, under Levitical priesthood, they were all pointing to Yeshua becoming an object of sin, because the scriptures again says he became sin. He became sin that we might be made the righteousness of Elohim in and through him. So those animals, they would lay their hands on them and they would transfer their sin and their guilt to the head of that animal. And they were looking forward to, and it was just a type and a shadow of the work that Yeshua was going to do in giving his life on behalf of all those on the planet. So the blood in the altar, the next thing that was done after the bull is killed before Yahweh, we learn the blood of the bull was applied first to the four horns of the altar and then poured out at the base of the altar. Most significantly, the horns on the four corners of the altar prophetically and symbolically pointed to the fact that Yeshua's blood poured out at the cross or at the altar offers salvation to all humans, those who trust him from the four corners of the earth, and it redeems them from their sins. In addition, we also discussed the New World Order and the world's preparation for the lawless one, the Antichrist. The leaders of this world are working behind the scenes and setting the stage for the whole world to embrace the Antichrist. It is important for those who desire to walk with Yahweh in spirit and in truth to study the scriptures and arm themselves against the strong delusions that are destined to impact this world. So we covered all this information and more in last week's teaching. I certainly want to encourage all of you that have not seen it, or if you have, get a chance to review that again. And that is the teaching on the blood and the altar. So we discussed the elements of the temple. So far in this series, we have examined the Ark of the Covenant, a type of Yeshua's death and burial, the table of showbread, pointing to the regathering of all 12 tribes of Israel, the lampstand, depicting Yeshua as the light of the world, the tabernacle of Moshe, pointing to Yeshua's sacrifice and our body as a temple of the Holy Spirit, the brazen altar and courtyard, pointing to Yeshua's final gift and office as priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, and the priestly garments, pointing to Yeshua as high priest and believers as kings and priests to our Elohim. Recently, we began studying the service of the temple, which involves the consecration of the priests, pointing to our holy priesthood to Yahweh, and the blood and the altar, pointing to Yeshua, the horn of our salvation, and his blood poured out to the four corners of the earth. Today, we're going to be looking at various offerings. Now, let's continue our study of the book of Exodus, part 16. We're going to be in the chapter 29 of Exodus, looking first at the sin offering. Verse 13, and you shall take all the fat that covers the internal organs and the cover of the liver and the two kidneys and the fat that is on them and burn them on the altar. But the meat of the bull and its skin and its dung, you shall burn with fire outside the camp. Now notice as you look at this, these things that will be burned outside the camp, They've got a cross here, which is indicating that this is a type and a shadow of Yeshua being outside the camp. We're going to deal with that in more detail. It says here, it is a sin offering, the burnt offering. And take one ram, and Aharon and his sons shall lay their hands on the head of the ram. And you shall kill the ram, and you shall take its blood and sprinkle it around on the altar. Again, as you go through these offerings, you're frequently seeing the blood, the blood, the blood. It is because all of this is pointing to Yeshua's blood being shed on the altar of Golgotha's hill. So all of this was nothing but a type and a shadow of Yeshua shedding his blood on behalf of the world. You shall cut the ram into pieces and wash his innards and his legs and put them with his pieces and with his head. And you shall burn the whole ram on the altar. It is a burnt offering to Yahweh. It is a pleasant aroma, an offering made by fire to Yahweh. And consecrating the priests. And you take the other ram, and Aharon and his sons shall lay their hands on the head of the ram. Then you shall kill the ram and take some of his blood, put it on the tip of the right ear of Aharon and on the tip of the right ear of his sons, on the thumb of their right hand and on the big toe of their right foot, and sprinkle the blood where? Around the altar. The sin offering. Again, we see Aharon and his sons lay their hands upon the head of the bull. There was nothing casual or perfunctory about this action. In other words, they did not take this process lightly. By laying hands on the head of the bull, Aharon and his sons identified themselves with the animal about to be killed. This action was a symbolic acknowledgement of their sinfulness and their confession before Elohim that they deserved death because of their sin. Killing the bull was an admission that we deserve to die. But Elohim, in his grace, accepts the death of this animal instead of my death. Significantly, the sin offering had to be carried without the camp to be destroyed by fire. Yeshua is our sin offering. Indeed, the sin offering for all mankind. Staying true to the type and shadow of this offering, our Savior also suffered without or outside the camp. We're now in Hebrews 13. Therefore, Yeshua also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffer where? Outside the gate. Therefore, let us go forth to him outside the camp, bearing his reproach. It is important to note the design and form of this offering was prophesied by Elohim as a future event before the Roman Empire existed. Yahweh looked 500 years in the future to see that Yeshua will be crucified outside the walls of Jerusalem. So again, there's a reason why he does everything he does. Yahweh is very purposeful in what he does. And so this was by design to kill a portion of this animal outside the gates, the burnt offering. Despite the fact of the bull having been called a sin offering and this ram a burnt offering, they are very similar. One animal alone could not adequately typify the Mashiach because the type required that the animal be consumed wholly upon the altar and at the same time be burned without the camp. Therefore, two beasts were required. Also, the lamb slain from the foundation of the world could not be adequately represented by a bull, a single bull. Yet there was nothing else to represent the enormity of humanity's load of guilt until Yeshua HaMashiach himself showed up on the scene. The enormity of our guilt is made clear by the enormity of the gift given to satisfy our guilt and shame, the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach. I'm going to give that some thought. The creator of heaven and earth, right? The very son of Elohim was a gift given. You can't get any higher than that. The scriptures say clearly, for Elohim so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. In addition, the son was willing to give his life. In fact, he laid his own life down. Even when Pontius Pilate was trying to say, don't you know I got power to take your life? He said, whoa, 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 check yourself right now. Right, pump your brakes, Pontius Pilate. Nobody has power over my life. This one thing I received from my father, I can lay my life down and I can take it back up again. So you would have no power over me at all if my father had not given it to you. Know you not that I can call right now 12 legions of angels, and in a moment they will come and rescue me. So you're not taking my life. I give it freely. I mean, what I'm saying. That's Yeshua. That's his willingness to shed his blood on behalf of all mankind, consecrating the priests. The other ram, called the ram of consecration, is used for the most unique portion of the entire ceremony. The application of the blood to the person of priesthood was the most significant. It was the crowning act of the consecration and implied the complete dedication of their lives and of all their powers to the service of the Most High Elohim. The blood on the ear, the thumb, and the toe. The symbolism here is not hard to see. The blood anointed ear must always be willing to hear Elohim's word. The blood anointed thumb on the right hand symbolizes hands that are ever ready to do Elohim's will. And the blood anointed toe is a symbol of feet ever committed to walk in the way of righteousness and truth. The hearing ear. Psalm 78. Give ear, O my people, to my Torah. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from their children, showing to the generation to come the praises of Yahweh and his strength and his wonderful works that he has done. John 10:27. My sheep do what? Hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. So clearly, we should really purpose to have a hearing ear, to hear his word, to hear his instruction, so that we can walk in it. The working hands, from Psalms 18, starting at verse 20. Yahweh rewarded me according to my righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands hath he recompensed me. There's a message there. You should desire to have clean hands. In fact, there's another verse of scripture that says, he that has clean hands shall wax stronger and stronger. Psalms 18:34. He teaches my hands to war so that a bow of steel is broken by my arms. That's powerful. That's like running through a troop and leaping over a wall. Yahweh is able to make your hands powerful to do war on his behalf. The righteous walk. Starting at Colossians, the first chapter. For this cause, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. For what purpose? That you might walk worthy of Yahweh unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of Elohim. That is powerful. This is one of my frequently quoted verses of scripture here, right? That you might walk worthy of Yahweh, how? Unto all pleasing. How many want to walk before him in all pleasing? Being fruitful. Think about that now. Being able to be fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of Elohim. That is a powerful verse of scripture right there. And Colossians 4 and 5. Walk in wisdom towards them that are without, that you might redeem time. That basically means by walking in wisdom, you're actually able to buy back time. Have you ever felt like you wasted time? Have you ever felt like in your life that you know, if you had just known something earlier, you could have made a difference earlier? But the Most High is saying in his word that by walking in wisdom, especially towards those that are without, who does that mean? Those that are not saved, those that are unsaved around you. When you walk in wisdom towards them that are without, you're redeeming the time. You're buying back time. So it's important that we learn how to walk upright, walk properly before him. So just to give you a little tidbit, this is Shabbat. So this evening, you should get some anointing oil and you should anoint your right earlobe. You should anoint your right thumb and you should anoint your right big toe. So you can make this commitment to the Most High Elohim that you want to hear him, hear his word, hear his voice, that you want to work on his behalf. You want your hands to be busy doing those things that are pleasing in his sight. And you want to walk worthy of him, right? You want to walk in an upright way that you can walk worthy of him and do all those things that are pleasing in his sight. So every week on Shabbat, you should make it a point to anoint those three parts of your body. Again, your right earlobe, your right thumb, and your right big toe as a form of dedicating your life to him, that you're gonna walk uprightly before him. So what are Yahweh's plans for his people? What exactly is Yahweh's plans for his people? As we look at Exodus 19, this is even before the Levitical priesthood came into play. He made a declaration about his people, starting in verse 5. Now, therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. Now, he's talking to Moshe and the children of Israel that have just come out of Mizraim. They have just come out of Egypt. And he's saying that you're going to be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people groups on the planet. So that's letting you know this people that he called out were very serious to him, very important to him, because as I've mentioned in other lessons before, the whole world rejected him at the Tower of Babel. They made up their mind they did not want to serve the Most High Elohim. And so Elohim had to start all over again and find someone who was willing to follow him. And he found Abram. And Abram became the father of faith. Abram became the one that was going to be obedient, even to the point of leaving his father's house and leaving his country and going to a place that the Most High said, I will show you when you get there, right? And so his offspring, Isaac, and his grandson, Jacob, and their 12 children, they became the foundation of this people group, this peculiar treasure unto Yahweh. He said, as I'm starting again at verse 5, now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, his covenant that he established with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. He's saying all the earth is mine, but I'm singling you out as a peculiar treasure from among other people groups. And you shall be unto me what? A kingdom of priests and an holy nation. So that was the original calling for this group of people, to be a kingdom of priests, not just the Levitical priesthood, but all of them were called to be a kingdom of priests. So what does that mean? The job of a priest is to be a go-between. So a priest serves the king. And the Most High Elohim is king of all. He is Elohim of all. And so this holy nation, this kingdom of priests had an assignment to make Elohim known to the strangers, to make Elohim known to the other nations of the world. And they were doing that. They were doing that. You know, as they were progressing, the fear of Yahweh was on all those that were around them. They knew, their hearts were melted because they were the offspring, they were the children of Elohim, right? They knew when they got to Jericho, they went spying out the land, and Rahab told them, all the people's heart are melting because of y'all. We already heard what y'all did to Egypt. We already know that you serve the one true Elohim, and we have fainted. But I will hide you out so they don't find you. And if I do this good thing for you, will you protect me and protect my family? And they did that. And because this harlot, Rahab the harlot, was willing to protect the two spies, the Most High Elohim saw fit to put her in the lineage of Yeshua HaMashiach. How much more powerful can you get than that? Faith is a powerful, powerful tool. So he went on to say, verse 6, and you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak unto the children of Israel. And Moshe came and called for the elders of the people and laid before their faces all these words which Yahweh commanded him. So this was the original call, the original purpose and plan that Yahweh had for the children of Israel. As we see in Exodus 19, the entire nation of Israel was chosen to be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. This assignment would have given all of the children of Israel the responsibility to lead the pagan nations among them to the one true Elohim, creator of heaven and earth. Israel's failure to complete this assignment and their rejection of Elohim's ways led to their eventual punishment, which included the transatlantic slave trade and scattering to the four corners of the earth. This was destined to happen. In fact, by the time they got to, let's just say, the book of Deuteronomy, he said, when all these things happen to you, the blessings and the cursing, because the Most High had already revealed to Moshe, the day is coming. Now, you're getting ready to die, but the day is coming where they're going to leave me, and they're going to do all the things they got in their heart, which is against me. And he told the same thing to Joshua, right? That they're gonna leave me. And so Joshua said, hey, for me and my house, we're gonna serve the Most High Elohim. Y'all can do what y'all wanna do, but we're gonna serve him. As soon as Joshua died, the roller coaster started. Today, there are two very important missions that I work hard to complete. The first one is to wake up the lost tribe of Israel, helping them to know who they are and why they were called, and to seek and save all of the lost of this world from every nation and people and tongue. Part of the curse that the children of Israel would endure is a loss of their identity. The prophet Jeremiah spoke of this in chapter 17, verse 1. The sin of Yehuda is written with a pen of iron and with a point of a diamond. It is graven upon the table of their heart and upon the horns of your altars. While their children remember their altars and their groves by the green trees upon the high hills, O my mountain in the field, I will give thy substance and all thy treasures to the spoil, and thy high places for sin throughout all thy borders. So in other words, he's saying, you guys have made a decision to serve other gods. I'm going to cause you to become a spoil to the nations. And thou, even thyself, shall what? Discontinue from thy heritage that I gave you. So a heritage is something that you remember that you received from your fathers, right? That's your heritage. Your heritage is what you remember from your father, from your grandfather, from your great-grandfather. Some people have been jewelers, some people have been goldsmiths, and they may have that trait, and they may carry that down from generation to generation to generation. That is their heritage. But what the Most High is saying here, that you shall discontinue from your heritage that I gave thee. What is that heritage? The Torah. He gave the children of Israel the Torah. We were the only people on the planet that had a living word from a living Elohim. And they discontinued from that heritage and began to serve other gods, pagan gods, that they had not known before. And so this is what he's saying here. Thou, even thyself, shall discontinue from thine heritage that I gave you, and I will cause thee to serve thine enemies in the land which thou knowest not. For you have kindled a fire in my anger, which shall burn forever. We know that great anger was kindled in the Most High Elohim because of the transgressions of our fathers. However, Yahweh has promised to regather the children of Israel and restore them to the promised land given to the fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And look at Jeremiah 30. Interestingly, this is the same prophet that prophesied that they would be discontinued from their heritage, but he also prophesied good over them. So we're in Jeremiah 30, starting at verse 1. The word that came to Jeremiah from Yahweh, saying, thus speaks Yahweh Elohim to Israel, saying, write thee all the words that I have spoken unto thee in a book. For lo, the days come, says Yahweh, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Yehuda, saith Yahweh. And I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it. Now, if it stopped right there, that would be good enough, right? He said, I'm going to remember you, and I'm going to bring you back. And these are the words that Yahweh spake concerning Israel and concerning Yehuda. More importantly, many of the nations who held the Hebrew captive and have continued to oppress them even to this day, they have relished in their dominance. As a result, the Most High Elohim have promised to avenge his people and restore their prominence on the earth. Now we're in Isaiah 49. We're going to start at verse 14. But Zion says, Yahweh has forsaken me, and Yahweh has forgotten me. And Yahweh is asking this question. Would a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of her womb? Though they forget, I never forget you. See, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are always before me. Your sons shall hurry. Your destroyers and those who laid you waste depart from you. This is Yahweh speaking, y'all. He's got a change of heart. Lift up your eyes around about and see. All of them gather together and come to you. As I live, declares Yahweh, you shall put on all of them as an ornament and bind them on you as a bride does. Talking about lost children. For your wastes and your deserted places and the land of your destruction shall soon be too narrow for the inhabitants, while those who swallowed you up are far away. In other words, he's going to be so many people coming. It's going to be like, we don't have enough room for all the people that are coming. How many hear what I'm saying? The sons of your bereavement shall yet say in your ears, the place is too narrow for me. Make room for me to live. What was the promise that Yahweh made to Abraham? If you can count the stars in the sky, if you can count the sand on the seashore, so shall your seed be. This is what he's saying. It's going to be so many people, they're not going to be able to have enough room for everybody showing up. Verse 21. And you shall say in your heart, who has brought forth these for me, since I am bereaved and barren, and exile, and wandering to and fro? And who reared them? See, I was left alone. From where did these come? Thus said the Master Yahweh, see, I lift my hand up to the nations and set up my banner for the peoples, and they shall bring your sons in their arms and your daughters carried on their shoulders. And kings shall be your foster fathers, and their queens your nursing mothers. Now you get that? those people that were in the highest positions, those people that were possessing your kids, that were in the highest positions, right, causing them to be taken advantage of, are now going to be foster fathers and nursing mothers for you. Look at what it says here now in the yellow. They bow down to you with their faces to the earth and lick up the dust of your feet. I told you, I made a promise last week that I'm going to bring you that verse of scripture. They're practically licking the dust off your boots. How many hear what I'm saying? This is what the Most High is saying. They have had a season, and it's been a long season, where they've taken advantage of the people of Yahweh. But Yahweh is saying, he who laughs last has the best laugh. How many hear what I'm saying? Our bondage has been centuries, 400 years. But when we take over our position as kings and priests under Elohim, when Yahweh becomes king of the earth, he's going to be ruling and reigning for how long? 1,000 years. And we're going to be ruling and reigning with him. And all those nations that did not serve him, that are still living, that survived the war, they're going to be there for that 1,000 years doing what? Serving those of us who have been called to rule and reign with him for 1,000 years. So would you rather be those who are the privileged few who may live 70, at best maybe 100? You know, some live to be 110, right? Or would you want to be able to live forever and be able to rule and reign for 1,000 years at his side? And those who were your enemies are now having to serve you for 1,000 years. I think that last laugh is the best laugh. I mean, hear what I'm saying. Verse 23 again. And kings shall be your foster fathers, and their queens your nursing mothers. They bow down to you with their faces to the earth and lick up the dust of your feet. And you shall know that I am Yahweh. Those who waited for me shall not be ashamed. Can you get that? Those who wait for Most High Elohim, you will not be ashamed in your waiting. Is prey taken from the mighty and the captives of the righteous delivered? Yet thus says Yahweh, even the captives of the mighty are taken away, and the prey of the ruthless is delivered, and I strive with him who strives with you, and I save your children. This is the Most High talking. He said, I'm ready to fight on your behalf. Verse 26. And I shall feed those who oppressed you with their own flesh and let them drink their own blood as sweet wine. All flesh shall know that I, Yahweh, am your Savior and your Redeemer, the Mighty One of Yaakov, right? The Mighty One of Israel. He is our Savior, our Redeemer. So there's none greater than him. He's the one you want to have on your side. How many hear what I'm saying? So remember now, our victory is assured. We must commit to walk in love and fulfill our priestly work on this earth. That's our only requirement. That's our only assignment, because the Most High is counting on us to complete our assignment. You know, there are people that are lost, and because of the foolishness that's going on in the church, they don't even know the truth. The enemy has been very effective in hiding the truth of the word. And there's a lot of tradition that's going on in the church today that of keeping this truth camouflaged. And it's by design. It's for a reason. Because they do not want the people, they do not want the church to know what the real is. And we talked about this a few weeks ago. You got the purpose of the Masonics, who are looking to have the whole world to worship Satan, right? That's their goal, to have the whole world worship Satan. And so in the end time, their goal is to have the church to become so disillusioned with their faith. And the Bible even says there's going to be a great falling away. The scriptures say clearly, it's going to be a great falling away. And so the reason for the falling away is because there are false expectations. The church has an expectation of events to take place that are not going to take place. And I did a thorough teaching on the rapture, right? And the fact that rapture is a false message, this pre-tribulation rapture, believing that it's going to be caught away before all the madness starts. And so what's going to happen to a church, 99% of the church waiting and believing that they're going to be delivered before the Antichrist shows up. And then all of a sudden, they find out that they're talking about, what? You got to get a mark of the beast before you can buy and sell? Wait a minute, I know what this is all about. Why am I still here? And they're talking about the mark of the beast. I'm supposed to be out of here. And so when the church finds out that they've been sold a bill of goods and they're still down here, when the Antichrist is on the scene, they're going to believe that if the rapture is not right, then how much other stuff have I been taught that is wrong? Because they dare to believe the traditions of men rather than to get into that word and learn exactly what the Most High said in his word. And so Albert Pike, he already said, we have a plan set up and we're going to cause both the atheists and the religious to forsake their way. And when everything is said and done, everybody's going to be serving the devil. And the book of Revelation made it clear. I talked about that last week. Everybody whose name is not written in the Lamb's book of life are going to be going after the beast. Who can make war with him? The whole world is going to be going after him. And so he says, we got to realize, if you're not walking in the truth of Yahweh's word, you're going to be lost. You're going to come under what the Bible talks about, strong delusion. And you're going to find yourself believing lies. And it's the only way, I mentioned last week, you talk to 10 people, and 9 out of 10 people know about the beast. You know, they know about the mark of 666. They know about not being able to buy and sell. They've heard that for years, and they know about it. And they know that to serve that beast means to be on the wrong side of the Most High Elohim. So how can you know that and still make a commitment to take that mark? You got to ask yourself that question. Is something serious going to happen in the mind of a person who's been taught that much of the truth, and then when everything is said and done, they're willing to succumb and to get the mark of the beast so they can buy and sell for 3.5 years on this earth just so they can, you know, get a piece of bread and forsake their salvation and to forsake eternity for 3.5 years, right, to be able to buy and sell? That's foolishness. That's foolishness. But the vast majority of the people that you know are going to fall prey to that situation. So we have an assignment to become strong in Yahweh and in the power of his might, to be strong in his word, to fulfill our priestly work on this earth, that we can complete the assignment that the Most High is calling us for. And so with that, we're going to conclude today. So who are we talking about? The Elohim of Israel. Why? Because he is the one true Elohim. So we trust you've gotten something out of this today. We're going to continue this lesson. It's like every segment of this book of Exodus has some very awesome and powerful information that we need to know that's going to help to enhance our walk with the Most High Elohim. All right? So we're going to get ready to pray out. Hallelujah. Aaronic benediction. Yivarekai Yahweh Barishmanekah. Ya'er Yahweh Panavaleka Ve'ekameka. Yisai Yahweh Panavaleka Ve'esimleka. Shalom. May Yahweh bless you and keep you. May Yahweh make his face shine upon you and show you his favor. And may Yahweh lift his countenance upon you and do what? Give you shalom, peace, nothing missing, nothing broken, and nothing lacking. That's his goal for each and every one of you under the sound of my voice. I also want to remind each and every one of you to get a chance to visit our YouTube channel. That is Dr. Russ E. Hoover. Get a chance to visit that. We have over 80 videos there now. We've gone through the book of Genesis. We've talked about the feast days, the 7 annual feast days, and the Shabbat. You definitely want to get a chance to listen to those lessons and reinforce your belief and understanding of the importance of those feast days and how they reveal the very plan of salvation. I mean, hear what I'm saying. You get a chance to do that. And when you go there, make sure you do all those YouTube-y things, right? Make sure you subscribe to the channel. Watch the videos and give them a thumbs up. And also hit that chime of notification so that when we're dropping new videos, you will be notified that we're dropping those videos and you can get there quickly and early and be among those first ones to listen. Also get a chance to leave comments as well, because by doing so, it helps me to know if you have questions. I'd just like to get a chance to hear what's on your heart and how the word is impacting you. So make sure you share that with your family and friends as well. And listen, Saints, I just want to remind all of you that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And I've been doing a lot of this lately. I've been cheating and reading the end of the book. And this is what I discovered. We win and the devil loses. And so with that said, this is Dr. Russi Hoover. We are signing off. Enjoy the rest of your Shabbat. Until next time, Shavua Tov. Have a blessed, blessed week. All right. Shavua Tov, family.
Shavua Tov.